Hey guys, Adam from Tessid. I am talking to you from Weta Workshop in New Zealand. And of course, Weta is famous for their incredible film work on films like Ghost in the Shell, Lord of the Rings, to name two of the hundreds and hundreds of movies they've worked on here. But Weta is about so much more than just film. They're also about architectural design and art, private art, public art. And within the realm of public art, they have been working with a sculptor out of New York named Sabin Howard. And they have been assisting him in building this beautiful 10-foot-long maquette of a sculpture he's working on about World War I, and we're going to get a tour through that sculpture.
Sabin,
hey Adam, pleasure.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you. Likewise.
This is I've come to see this thing behind you. Tell me what's going on. This is an amazing diorama.
Well, this is kind of like a very revolutionary piece. It's a National Memorial maquette that's going to agency review in Washington.
So this is a maquette. So this is a scale model of something that you've designed. It's a World War I memorial, right?
That's right. And this is a 1/6 scale. And this will be eventually something that's 65 feet in length.
Whoa.
Yeah.
And made out of bronze?
Bronze.
Wow.
Bronze. Yep.
Holy cow.
Yeah. 38 figures. Yeah. And you have 3 acts. 5 scenes, and it's a story that progresses from left to right.
Will you walk me through the scenes?
I'd love to.
Okay.
That would be great. So the first scene is the family scene, and this section here is basically seen as the beginning section. And it's following like a template from Joseph Campbell's and the idea of the monomyth.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a hero and the hero's journey, and that's why I called it a soldier's journey.
Okay.
So I made this analogy between the soldier and the hero. And I didn't want to make a monument to somebody higher up in the military, but I wanted to do a monument to the common man. And that's why I did a father.
The men who fought the war.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it starts off with a father on his knee receiving the helmet from his daughter, and his wife stands behind him stoically. Then the next scene, the father starts to proceed and leaves his wife behind, and then he joins the men. And then you have this next scene, which is the bridge, which is the Atlantic Ocean.
Right.
And you have this gap that presents then the battle scene. And this is now Europe. And it kinetically, you can see it's like speeds up drastically.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So you move into something that's very dramatic from something that's quiet. So it's like a symphony.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like has a crescendo.
And it's there's a group drama here reaching this crescendo of this man's face. They're going up over the ridge.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep. So I was trying to do something that, you know, your common art visitor to memorials, they're not into art, so you need to present something that's got a lot of drama.
Right.
And then there's also a lot of symbolism. I don't know if you can see, there's a giant X that runs through here. And this X from the battle scene to the cost of war scene that proceeds, that X goes to the helmets, and then this other X goes up to the father, who then reemerges out of the war.
This is our same character who
exactly.
we began with.
And the thing is, he's not just a father, he's also a representation of America.
Yeah.
So you have this allegory where, several allegories, like he's America reborn, it's
right.
a new country that goes from an agrarian nation to almost a superpower. It's also what happens in war, and it also follows the monomyth idea that from this leaving home to entering into this other world, you get a resurrection and a rebirth. So there's lots of symbolism there.
Well, you also have, he's visibly changed. You have
exactly.
an art, the character has been visibly altered
I'm
by
glad
his experience.
You see that.
You've given him a mile-long stare.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen pictures of soldiers coming off the line being relieved after losing 90% of their battalion in World War I, and they look just like that. They look wrecked. They look exhausted.
I'm very happy you say that, because I changed like my whole work, the way that I worked in making my art. I went from a classicist to becoming like a humanist and an expressionist.
Really?
Yeah, to do this project. It was like a transformation for me too, as an artist.
Wow.
Yeah, so I kind of had to live, and leaving New York, coming to New Zealand, is a transformation for sure.
Yes, yeah.
You know?
This is culturally a very different place, yeah. Okay,
yeah.
Let's go. So,
so then you have
one last act,
yeah.
yes?
So then you have this rise from the ground. The battle scene drives to the down, and mm-hmm. then you have this massive rise starting here. Look at what the highest point is. It's the flag.
Right.
So from here, cost of war, like this pietà scene, then this mustard gas scene, right, this rye. Blinded. Yeah, look at the, you get the rye, and then I buttressed him with females on each side. Mm-hmm. So the females are very prominent in the sculpture. Did you notice that the bookends?
It's
a girl. And then here, the bookends of the soldier, it's a girl, women as well. Then I call this part the Three Amigos. So this is this hero looking backwards. And then the next scene is almost like this Johnny Come Marching Home scene.
Mm-hmm. Almost a parade, the reception.
Exactly. And then the final scene is the father who hands his daughter the helmet. And I want you, if you notice, look, he's smaller here than here. Right. And so this is my take on, there's nothing redeeming in war except that it's this human connection. And the piece is all about human connection. It's relational.
We do superhuman things, but we're still human.
Yeah. There's not a single figure that's like alone except him.
Yeah.
They're all like this.
I love the fact that she hands him the classic doughboy, which is like the symbol of World War I, that helmet. Yeah. She hands it to him right side up, but he's giving it back upside down.
Yep.
It's there's an exchange happening.
Yeah, no, that's the next generation. So we know it happens after World War I, World War II.
So can you give me an idea about what kind of research you do for this?
Oh,
what kind
God.
Of research did you do for this piece? And how did it come to shape in your
well,
mind?
Well, it's very human because, also, you know, my wife's a novelist, so she's has a lot of influence on my storytelling. It's huge.
Yeah.
Because I didn't come into the project thinking about story. So then I got in the studio and I realized you need to tell a story and recreate World War I. So I got actors out of Brooklyn, Bronx, just kids, like in their 20s, and I got real uniforms. I started posing them. And I started taking pictures with my cell phone and setting up scenes that would tell this whole story. But then each segment was, I'd shoot like 15 iterations on it.
Right.
And so making the story was something that took 9 months. So the research came from actually experiencing those people under lights with uniforms acting out human feelings and drama.
And you're watching them and thinking about them. Yeah. You're thinking about them representing the folks who actually went to war. You're thinking about what they went through.
Exactly. So it took on a tremendous amount of significance because it wasn't something that was didactic and historical just out of a book. Mm-hmm. That was the driving force. But the impetus was like, look at the imagery. And then the imagery, recreate the imagery in your studio. And then the story just started to come in, almost like I was a conduit for this thing that's floating out there.
It's a really fascinating way that you physicalized the narrative. There's a journey, and there's also a journey that the viewer takes, walking from one end of this to the other. He's a giant if this is 65 feet tall, 65 feet long.
Yeah, he would be 7 feet.
So just...
And you're two feet off the ground.
So everything is bigger than you are.
But not like you're not going into classical scale, you're still staying in human scale.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this sense of like interaction. I didn't want to make it something that's untangible.
Right, right.
Something that you couldn't reach. So I'm really trying to make a human connection here.
And how did you find Weta Workshop to do this here? This is literally the other side of the world.
Bizarre, 9,000 miles away from New York. I got an email from Richard. I'm saying, I'd like to visit your studio. I didn't know who Richard was. Barely knew where New Zealand was, in fact. Sorry. and then Richard came and he said, well, we just did Scale of Our Wars at Te Papa, the National Memorial here. And this is exactly the same art process that you used humans, you took pictures, you tried to recreate the drama, the human feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, he said, come over. And I got a plane ticket and showed up 2 weeks later. And it was a reconnaissance. And so then from there, I came back in July and proceeded to knock this out. Now we're January. So that's pretty fast.
Yeah.
This is.
And I see paint marks. Literally, you are in the process of finishing this, and this is for final approvals. Is that right?
Concept approval now.
Concept approval.
Yeah. I have to go in front of the Commission of Fine Arts to get their approval because it's a federal mandate in public land. For a national memorial, so there's a lot of bureaucratic just process that I have to proceed through.
So you'll fly to DC with this?
With this, yeah. This gets crated.
Yeah.
Three sections packed away, and then I uncrate it on the other end. and then I bring it over to the commission
so
office.
So multiple, and if they accept it, there's another couple of years to complete this?
Yeah, I don't think it's an if. It will get...
Okay, so when they accept this?
Yeah, it's more... I have to go through a process now. I would double this in scale and do one that's 20 feet to bring even more detail to it.
Right.
And then from that, then I have to enlarge that to the full scale and work on the final piece in clay for several years. So it's a process still.
Would you do some efficiencies? If you make this double size and then you're going to go full scale, there are some rapid prototyping and scanning techniques you can use to flesh out, I guess, the bulk details.
That's right. You get the grunt work out of the way with the technology. So that's a really interesting point you're bringing up. I did 30 years of just very traditional work. Clay, metal tools, pencil, paper.
Yeah.
And then this is new ground completely. Yeah. It's like I stepped into something that I'd never played with before.
Well, it's one of the things I love about Weta is that they play with the oldest techniques imaginable and are totally open to and embracing the brand newest technology there is.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I can't go backwards now across the bridge.
So the arc is also in you. You have been physically changed through this process.
Definitely, definitely.
It is absolutely gorgeous.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you for walking me through this.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thanks for listening.
I can't wait to see more about this process and to eventually visit the piece in Washington.
Well, I look forward to having that moment come true.
Oh, it really is stunning.
Thanks.